Oops. Ooh, Ikes. Good morning, church.
Morning.
A little wake-up noise there this morning. Welcome to this beautiful day. We are honored and just really full of joy to have Pastor Paul Arnold bring us the sermon, the message today, as well as officiating for communion with us. So we'll be in fellowship with him with all of that later today. So looking forward to all of that this morning. As we join here today, whether it be in person or online, we know that we're in the presence of the Lord. I am reminded this morning, especially of Psalm 100 that says, "Shout with joy to the Lord, all the earth. Worship the Lord with gladness. Come before him with joyful songs." May that truly be our spirit this morning, especially as we begin by listening to more beautiful music. Please stand as you are able and join me in the call to worship. Come, give to the Lord your praises of thanksgiving.
I come this day grateful for God's.
Sing with great enthusiasm of God's mighty power and love.
We celebrate that love that frames our lives.
It is a wonderful thing to praise God. Please remain standing for the singing of our opening hymn, Joyful, Joyful, We Adore Thee. The scripture this morning comes from Luke chapter 15, verses 1 through 10. Now all the tax collectors and sinners were coming near to listen to him. And the Pharisees and the scribes were grumbling and saying, "This fellow welcomes sinners and eats with them." So he told them this parable: "Which one of you, having 100 sheep and losing one of them, does not leave the 99 in the wilderness and go after the one that is lost until he finds it? When he has found it, he lays it on his shoulders and rejoices. And when he comes home, he calls together his friends and neighbors, saying to them, 'Rejoice with me, for I have found my sheep that was lost.' Just so I tell you, there will be more joy in heaven over one sinner who repents than over 99 righteous people who need no repentance. Or what woman, having 10 silver coins, if she loses one of them, does not light a lamp, sweep the house, and search carefully until she finds it? When she has found it, she calls together her friends and neighbors, saying, 'Rejoice with me, for I have found the coin that I had lost.' Just so, I tell you, there is joy in the presence of the angels of God over one sinner who repents."
Was in the beginning, is now, and ever
You may be seated.
Good morning.
Good morning.
It's good to be with you. As Janet said, my name is Paul Arnold. Many years ago now, I served as an interim here when you were between pastors. It seems like you're always between pastors. What's going on? It's all right. It's just good. It's good to be with you. Four and a half years ago, I preached a sermon here on the Sunday prior to Pastor Heather's coming and her arrival. It seems like I show up on the Sunday before, you know, I don't know. But that sermon was about the Good Shepherd, related in the 10th chapter of John. In fact, I'm sure that those of you who were here at that time just remember it well, right? I got one hand. That's good. Oh, a couple more. Anyways. In fact, when Heather asked me to lead worship today, I told her, well, yeah, I would work on it. And she said, well, you can use that same sermon that you used on that Sunday. And she had looked at it and said that it worked and it would be appropriate. I'm not going to do that. But the point of that message was that the role of a pastor is often referred to as the shepherd of the flock. But the problem is, there's only one shepherd. Right? Remember in the passage in John where Jesus said to us, I am the good shepherd. So the pastor, in my thinking, should not be called the shepherd, but rather be called the sheepdog. In fact, we're like two or three slides ahead. That if you want to go back another one. There we go. Just leave it there for a while. In fact, do you remember the last words of Heather to me at the farewell 3 weeks ago when Heather said to me, "I have been the sheepdog"? You know. Now, as I said, I'm not going to share that sermon, but the key parts of that sermon are worth sharing for a moment. You see, the shepherd, during his appearance following the resurrection, asked Peter, "Do you love me?" And Peter says, "Yes, Lord, I love you." He asked him three different times, "Do you love me?" "Yes, Lord, I love you." And in response, when he said, "I love you," Jesus said to Peter, "Tend my sheep. Feed my sheep." An actual sheepdog's task is to keep the flock focused on the leading of the shepherd. That's its task. And so it is in the church. The sheepdog's task is to keep the flock focused on Jesus, the shepherd. That's the task of a pastor. And so we are to follow the shepherd. The sheepdog is the servant of the shepherd and the servant's flock. So what is it that you can do to help your new sheepdog, Pastor Esta, to be the best sheepdog? And I'm sorry that those are pretty small. The first thing you can do is encourage her to have time to keep her relationship strong with the shepherd. Give her personal devotion and study time. Because the stronger her relationship with the shepherd, the stronger her relationship with you. The second thing, support her when she has to nip the heels of that sheep that wants to lead the flock in a different direction. Okay? Away from the shepherd. And that probably will happen with you folks, you know, here. The third thing you can do is to give her a pat on the head once in a while, and I don't mean literally, but let her know that you appreciate her. The fourth thing, give her some rest time. She needs to have those days off, that vacation time. It's tough keeping sheep in line all the time. And again, especially with you folks. No, I'm just giving you a hard time. And the final thing you can do is to pray for her. Pray for her. Add her name to your prayer list, Esther Rosario. Pray for her. In fact, my prayer for your congregation is that you will not only get along with your new sheepdog, Esther, but that she will constantly keep your eyes focused on the shepherd. And knowing her as I do, I know that you will be in good hands. You will be in good hands. Well, that was the message 4.5 years ago or so, and that's the end of that message. And now I want to start a new message. So you get two for one today. But how many of you have had to look all over your house for something you knew was there, but you just couldn't find it? Yeah? And it's not just an age thing, but you can't find it. Somehow it was not where you thought it was. Or most likely, your spouse moved it without telling you. I mean, that's happened in our house. And I'm usually the one that moves But you have had that experience of searching for something important and somehow it's lost. Our scripture lesson this morning, Jesus describes that event. Jesus knew how we can search for what is important to us, and his point is that God is like that. God loves us so much. While describing this love for us, Jesus reminded us that God's love goes even further than we might expect. And so in these parables, Jesus is talking about the kingdom of God and God's limitless task on finding us who are lost and celebrating then with immeasurable happiness when one is found. We discover in this parable that in God's kingdom, God loves everyone. In fact, the passage started out, "The tax collectors and sinners were all drawing near to him," Jesus. "The Pharisees and scribes could not believe their eyes. They said, 'This man receives sinners and he eats with them.'" Now, the Pharisees gave to the poor because, you see, they had to in order to fulfill the law. The law said you gave a percentage of your money to the poor. But they despised the poor and the sinners, and they certainly would not associate with them. In fact, there's some laws about how close you could actually come. Jesus not only associated with them, but he ate with them. To sit at table with someone, even in our day, I think denotes acceptance. And you recall those holiday stories where a child in the family, you know, invites some homeless person to join the family for Thanksgiving or Christmas. You know, and the parents at first don't know what to do. They don't know the person or where they've been or what they've been doing. And now he or she has been invited to the family dinner. And I remember when I was the pastor at Faith United Methodist Church in Fort Wayne, we were working with Prison Fellowship, an organization that started years ago with Chuck Colson, who works to help people in prison to know that Jesus loves them and is their Lord as well. But anyway, the Prison Fellowship group was providing some volunteer labor on a neighborhood rehab project. We were down in the center city and we were rehabbing some houses around us. And the church was providing breakfast and lunch for the volunteers, including these men from the Michigan City prison. And it was a unique experience for our church volunteers to sit down with a meal with these men who were in prison. Now, normally, they wouldn't have had anything to do with them, but here they were eating together. You see, Jesus is telling us in this parable that this kingdom of God is incomplete. It's not whole as long as any feel kept out by who they are or where they have been or what they have done. And wonder of wonders, you see, every one of us can say, "I am included." We are all included. Each of us actually knows more about our own faults than anyone else's, right? I mean, there's some secrets and stuff in our own head that we've never told anyone, and we know that about us, you know. So each of us knows about ourselves, and we are surprised then when we hear, "I am included. I can be a part of the kingdom." No matter who we are, we can be included because, you see, God wants everybody. Now, because of this church's Swedish history, in fact, you know, you have the Swedish chapel, I wanted to share this story about an old-time evangelist by the name of Edgar DeWitt Jones. He was preaching a revival one time, and at the invitation, when he invited people to come and to accept Christ as their Lord, this huge, big, burly man came storming down the center aisle. There were tears streaming down his eyes. He marched right up to the altar rail, stuck out his hand to the Pastor Jones, and he said, "Pastor, you said tonight that God would save anyone, no matter who they are, no matter what they've done. I've done everything. I've done it all, preacher. Many times I've broken the Ten Commandments. I've even killed a man. I'm a Swedish blacksmith by trade. I don't know if God can help me." And then Pastor Jones says he was inspired by God as he tried to grasp this huge hand of the man. And he said to him, "Sir, tonight God is specializing in Swedish blacksmiths." My friends, today, God is specializing in United Methodists. Today, God is specializing in you. Because God is happy when you and everybody else are included in God's kingdom. So, how do we get into that kingdom? It's not by our own means, not by our own diligent searching. In fact, if poverty and sin won't keep us out, wealth and righteousness won't get us in. God does not wait to be sought, but God seeks. Like the shepherd, like the woman in the parable, God continues to seek in spite of all the odds or the futility of searching. You see, God loves to search. And we in the church should know about helping those who are hunting for things, hunting for new life. We're here, you see, to offer the lost and the lonely ones of the earth easy access to God's love that awaits them in Jesus Christ. But what happens too often, I think, in the church is that we tend to focus inward. We tend to focus on each other, right? Those who are already, quote, found, and we become a club for Christians, right? We just hang out together. We like being with each other. The church's primary mission is not to provide a meeting space or to reserve rooms for Sunday school classes or special groups, but rather the church's mission is to ring out the good news of the gospel to all of those who feel outside the walls or outside the church, those whom we call lost. They're probably not really lost, but our task is to welcome them to be a part of us. Now, fortunately, in our parable, it's God who's doing the searching. But also notice on the emphasis on the word lost. It's not on the condition of the thing lost, but the emphasis lies in the agony on the heart of the one who has lost something. The shepherd is suffering more than the wandering sheep. Sheep's probably having a good time, but the shepherd is concerned. The woman is suffering because this silver coin is lost. And because of that suffering, the shepherd or the woman, or shall we say, God, in looking after us, suffers when we are lost. In spite of all the other possibilities, all of the other sheep, all of the other coins, all of the other people, God still searches. God still searches for you and for me. Now, I think we would tend to cut our losses and move on. You know, and say, oh, well, it's not worth it, don't have the time. You know, but God does not. We can identify with the modern image of the farmer, the agribusiness person who would consider a 1% loss an acceptable cost of doing business. You know, it's okay, I've got 99. Or the retailer who knows that a certain percentage is going to be stolen or damaged, that's just a part of doing business. We have trouble, I know, identifying with a shepherd who would leave 99 and search for the one who is lost. And the reason that God is willing to continue that search, you see, is that God loves us. And when we are ready to give up, God is not. Now, that leads me then to the final things that happens when the lost is found. And it has to do with the emotion of the kingdom. The scripture says there is joy before the angels of God over one sinner who repents. And that kind of joy is over you or me. Have you ever tried to find someone whom you thought was lost? I mean, you were worried, an individual, you imagine all the worst possible things, a person, maybe a child, could be kidnapped, or someone's hurt, in pain, someone's lying, all, you know, by themselves. Yeah. When I was little, a little kid, I was about 7 or 8 years old. My family, my mom and dad, my four brothers, were attending a district Boy Scout jamboree. Remember those events? They were huge events. All the Boy Scout troops from all over got together in some big thing. My brother was big in Boy Scouts. It was a huge event. We were at this large scout campground. Well, after a while, my brother, Gail, who was 2 years older than I, came up missing. We couldn't find him anywhere. He'd wandered off. He was like that sheep. You know, he's wandered off somewhere. We looked everywhere in that campground. We could not find him. Eventually, we found him heading back from the car where it was parked some distance away because he decided that he was going to meet us at the car. You know, he knew we were going to get there, so he just wandered off and was going to meet us at the car. But what I remember most about that event was my mother's tears of joy and the hugs he received because he was found. I mean, to me, it was just my brother. I mean, so what? You know? but to my mom. Okay, it was her lost little boy who was found. There is great joy in the kingdom of God over one who is lost and is found. Now, we might say, well, another person has accepted God's love, or someone has done the smart thing. They've turned away. You know, they've come to church, they've joined the church, or they've been baptized, and we can record one more new member or whatever, you know, and then we just move on. But that's not the way the scriptures tell us that God responds. There is more joy in heaven over the one who is found than the other 99. You see, that's what God's love is all about. The kind of love, that's what we call grace. God's grace for all of us. The grace of God, which tells us, one, we are all included. Two, we're never given up on. God continues the search. And we are rejoiced over. We are worth being celebrated about. You see, there was a story about John Newton, who's an author. He sat down to write a hymn about this grace and love of Almighty God. Because you see, he was the one who had been lost. He had experienced God's grace in his life, and he knew he was a new person. So he decided to write a hymn. He was thinking about it. How can I do this? So he took out, you know, he took out his pen, and he was writing. He says, what shall I call this? I'll call this Beautiful Grace. And he wrote that down. He looked at it, said, no, that's not it. You know, and then he took his pen. He says, Wonderful Grace. Now, that's not it either. Amazing Grace. Amazing grace that God accepts you and me. Grace that continues to bring us into a relationship with him. And that rejoices over the lost who come into God's fellowship. The grace of God that makes us go out and search ourselves for the lost. Amazing grace. In the name of God, the Father, and Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen. I invite you, turn your hymnals or read the words as we stand together and sing Amazing Grace.
You may be seated. The altar flowers this morning are brought to us in honor of Nancy Hake's daughter Kylie's 25th birthday. What a joy that is for her. And we also are keeping in mind this week Lori Pierre, whose sister Linda is in hospice care. Prayers for Lori and Rick as they are there in Texas to be by her side. May we go to the Lord in prayer. Heavenly Father, we know it is by your grace that we have been saved, that you found us when we were lost, that if we become lost again, you will seek us and bring us back to you. We ask, Lord, for blessings on all of those who are celebrating birthdays and anniversaries, families being united. We know what a joy that is, Lord, and how the feeling of loss being found is there, and just the extra blessing of being together. We ask, Lord, that you be with all of those that are mourning loss, that are dealing with suffering and pain, those with family members who are passing from this world to yours. We ask all these things, Lord. We ask for special things that are in the hearts of each of us gathered here. We know you are here with us. We know you know the deepest prayers in our hearts. We ask, Lord, today, as we partake in communion, that we may feel a closeness to you, that we may know we are your people, your lost that have been found. Amen. This week, we have upcoming things coming on. Pastor Esta is preaching next Sunday, as has been referred to. There will be a short fellowship time following each of the services, so please stay around and take care of connecting with her. You may have noticed if you get the church emails each week, and hopefully you do. If you don't, sign up for them. They're wonderful ways to get information. That we're going to be having cottage meetings coming up as a chance to meet Pastor Esta in smaller settings. Right now, we're just asking for people to sign up to be the host or hostess for those. These are about an hour-long gathering sessions. Just if you want to provide light refreshments, that's fine, but just a chance for Pastor Esta to get to know people a little more intimately. And so once we have people signed up as host and hostess for those, there'll be lists out, and just please contact the office to sign up for the one that fits your schedule so you have a chance to meet and greet the pastor and for her to get to know you. That's certainly on her heart to be able to make that happen. That email is also a source of wonderful other information. I know at the end of this month we have a spaghetti dinner coming up on the last Friday of the month, so looking forward to that. And so as we're moving forward, we also have Lenten services coming up before long on Ash Wednesday, which is February 22nd. There will be a noon service in this room, and there will be a 7 p.m. service that will be downstairs, and that one it will be live streamed. So that if you can't make it in that day to either of those, you can take care of watching it online. As we are gathered here today and we are grateful for all that God has done for us, we have the opportunity to give back a small portion of all that he has given us. If you're in the room today, you may leave your offering at any time in the box in the back of the room. If you're not here, or if you didn't bring your offering with you and wish to give, that may be mailed in, it can be dropped off in the office. Or there are opportunities, if you go to the Chesterton website, to take care of making connections to make those donations online. Today, as we are thankful for all the Lord has done for us, may we be thankful as we listen to, again, more beautiful music.
Thank you.
We ask, Lord, today as we bring our offerings to you, be they financial, spiritual, or even gifts of ourselves, that you may take these gifts, blend them with gifts of others, multiply them, that they may be all used for your service to bring your kingdom here on earth. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. You may be seated.
Prepare ourselves for the receiving of Holy Communion. I invite you to share with me in a prayer of great thanksgiving to receive the responses. The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is right and a good and joyful thing always and everywhere to give thanks to you, Father Almighty, Creator of heaven and earth. You formed us in your image. You breathed into us the breath of life. When we turned away and our love failed, your love remained steadfast. You delivered us from captivity. You made covenant to be our sovereign God. You spoke to us through your prophets. And so, with your people on earth and all the company of heaven, we praise your name and now join their unending hymn. Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. Holy are you and blessed is your Son, Jesus Christ. Your Spirit anointed him to preach good news to the poor, to proclaim release to the captives, recovery of sight to the blind, to set at liberty those who are oppressed, and to announce that the time had come when you would save your people. He healed the sick, fed the hungry, ate with sinners. By the baptism of his suffering and death and resurrection, by his suffering and death and resurrection, you gave birth to your church, delivered us from slavery to sin and death, and made with us a new covenant by water and the Spirit. When the Lord Jesus ascended, he promised to be with us always in the power of your word and Holy Spirit. On the night in which he gave himself up for us, he took bread, gave thanks to you, broke the bread, gave it to his disciples, said, "Take, eat, this is my body given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." When the supper was over, he took the cup, gave thanks to you, gave it to his disciples, and said, "Drink from this, all of you. This is my blood of a new covenant poured out for you and many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me." And so, in remembrance of these, your mighty acts in Jesus Christ, we offer ourselves in praise and thanksgiving as a holy and living sacrifice in union with Christ's offering for us, as now we proclaim the mystery of faith. Christ has died. Christ has risen. Christ will come again. Pour out your Holy Spirit on us, gathered here on these gifts of bread and juice. Make them be for us the body and blood of Christ, that we may be for the world the body of Christ, redeemed by his blood. By your Spirit, make us one with Christ, one with each other, one in ministry to all the world, until Christ comes in final victory and we feast at his heavenly banquet. Through your Son, Jesus Christ, with the Holy Spirit in your holy church, all honor and glory is yours, Almighty Father, now and forever. Amen. And now, with the confidence of God's children, let us pray together the prayer he has taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Because there is one loaf, we, many as we are one, as we share together in the body of Christ, broken for you. And as we take from the cup, as a reminder of Jesus shed his blood for us, may we be strengthened. Amen. As we gather here, there'll be several stations at the front. Come, I'll break off the bread, hand it to you. You can dip that in the cup for the juice, or you may take one of these small containers as well and receive the juice that way as well. I invite those who are serving to come and assist as we share together in this sacrament of Holy Communion. You have received this sacrament of Holy Communion. May it nourish you and strengthen you this day and every day of your life. Amen.
Please stand and join me in singing our closing hymn, Savior, Like a Shepherd, Lead Us.
Savior, like a shepherd. I can't get the image of the shepherd and the sheepdog out of my mind, you know, as we see that. And I will not be here to introduce your next pastor, because Pastor S is going to be here a long, long time.
Amen.
And you will receive her blessing and her family, and you will be, as I said, in very good hands as you continue to minister in many different ways to this community and this area. So go in God's peace. God's peace go with you now and always. Amen.